very good afternoon to you and welcome from the MGM Grand Garden Arena here in Las Vegas, Nevada. We present the final press conference for the highly anticipated third installment for this long-awaited rematch for the WBC Heavyweight Championship of the World. Presented by Bob Arum's Top Rank Incorporated, Frank Warren, on behalf of Queensberry Promotions, Bomb Squad Promotions, and TGB Promotions, this is a Premier Boxing Champions presentation brought to you by FanDuel Sportsbook. Well, before we bring out our fighters at this time, let's take a closer look at the previous encounters between these two elite giants of the heavyweight division.
Absolutely electric. Fury on the attack, going to the head. This is a mauling effort from Fury. Look at this! Fury's all over him.
Our champion who defended his title 11 times, looking to avenge his only loss and to regain his title from Tuscaloosa, Alabama. Here is the former hard-hitting WBC heavyweight champion of the world, the Bronze Bomber, Deontay Wilder. Ladies and gentlemen, standing at 6'9", his record 30 wins, no losses, one draw with 21 wins, coming by way of knockout from Manchester, England. Here is the acclaimed two-time heavyweight world champion, the current and the undefeated WBC heavyweight champion of the world, the Gypsy King, Tyson Fury. Championship Trilogy, Fury versus Wilder, number 3, T-Mobile Arena, Saturday night, live on pay-per-view. And now, ladies and gentlemen, my pleasure to introduce the host of our press conference, acclaimed sports journalist, Kate Abdo.
Thank you all. Deontay, how you doing? Tyson, you want to take a seat?
I'm good, thanks, Kate. I've been sat down a long time. I'm going to stand up.
Do you not own any shirts, either?
I don't. This is the sexy look.
That's what they say. Deontay, you're making me nervous with the headphones. Are we feeling like talking today? Do us a favor. Okay, cool. Brilliant. Listen, you had to go through the courts, right, to get to this moment. What is it that you want to prove in the arena on Saturday night?
I don't have nothing to prove. You know, I'm in a great place. I'm in a great state of mind, have always been. You know, I got a lot of great people around me that's been covering me all this time, you know. It's nothing to prove at all. This right here is redemption, retaliation, retribution, you know, and all of the above.
I got you. It's a long way to look up at you. Won't you sit down for me?
I'm good.
All right, okay. So listen, 20 months, right? It's a long time to stay focused, to prove something that you feel that you've already proved, I assume. How have you managed to stay motivated during this time?
I've just been training there, Kate, you know, taking it day by day, enjoying my life, training for a fight, and that's all we can do. Live every day, one day at a time, and I look forward to today. Because every day we wake up is a blessed day, remember that.
Amen, that's true. You've had a lot to deal with in the meantime, though, right? Because you had, obviously, you had made the fight with AJ, then you had to deal with scrapping the fight with AJ, you had COVID that you had to deal with, your wife has had a baby, congratulations, by the way. How have you managed to stay dialed in, or at what point do you think you really got dialed into this fight?
All these fights are exactly the same to me. You know, I've got some guy trying to take me head off with punches. No matter if it's Deontay Wilder or whoever it may be, it doesn't really matter to me because it's a Tyson Fury roadshow. It's been continuing for 13 years. So I train every day in my life, twice a day mostly. I eat, sleep, train, repeat. You know, I've had a few personal problems at home, but you know, there's always gonna be some type of problem or hurdle to get over in life. So it's just how we do it, you know. And I had a little baby girl who was born seven and a half weeks ago, and she was very unwell for a minute or two. And, you know, I was there for 2 weeks in the hospital with her. And as soon as I knew that if I got that hurdle out the way, then I knew that things would be good and I could concentrate on the fight. And that's exactly what I did.
Do you feel comfortable being away from home?
Yeah, I'm 100% confident, you know. The baby's 100% at home, everyone's good, family's good, so, you know, daddy's just got to do his job now, that's it.
All right, okay. Deontay, we've seen these videos, and I think for fans it's been super exciting, right, to watch you look as motivated and as driven and as hungry as you have done. It's been 20 long months, though, right, that you've been waiting for this moment. Have you allowed your mind and your body a second to kind of step back at any point during that time?
We've been going from day one, since the last outing, you know, there hasn't been no stop. All the delays and all that, you know, have been beneficial for us. You know, we've been continuing to carry on. You know, one thing about this camp that I've had, I've been able to have all my brothers around me from the start, and we're here, we're all together now. You know, so I've been talking about the love that's been around me all this time, and it's been real. It's been amazing for me. You know, when many people thought I was down, depressed, and all that. I can't be. It wouldn't be fair to the people that I have around me to even feel that way. Certain things I didn't even know what was going on in the world, you know what I mean? Because of my focus and my dedication that I've had, you know? And it's just been amazing.
Overtraining is a real thing, though, right? So if they had to pull you back at times?
Overtraining is a real thing. And we've been able to stop at certain times, take breaks certain times, and get back at it. You know, certain things, it'll be a little lighter than others, you know, until we were able to get back on track, you know. So everything has been good. I think we've timed everything out perfectly. I think we've done all the right things. And come Saturday night, it's going to be definitely a different fight, you know, for all the fans. You know, they should be excited. You know, it's not rare that we get trilogies like this. And I think it's going to go down in history.
We are excited. I think it feels really different coming into this fight than it did coming into the second fight, right? After that first fight, it felt like there was still mutual respect between the two of you. After the second fight, it feels like that has been lost somewhat. Deontay, there were many accusations that you made towards Tyson about reasons that you felt that he had won that fight, ways that you felt that he had cheated. Do you regret any of the accusations that you made towards him?
I don't regret it, and I'll go to my grave believing in what I believe in. I know things for fact. I have confirmation, clarity of a lot of things, and which, you know, one thing about it, you know, men lie, women lie, but your eyes don't lie what you see, you know? So many people can believe what they want. We're all human. We believe what we want, but the eyes don't lie. And it only made me better as a man, as a fighter, to understand and to see certain things and know things for facts. You know, it made me even hungrier than before. God is a great God, and it's he don't make mistakes. I wouldn't take it back for nothing because even the way I felt, even coming into the fight, even when Chris took the mask off me, how I felt, I wouldn't take it back for nothing. I needed it. It was a blessing in disguise.
Tyson, he did accuse you of some of the biggest violations in boxing, right? You kind of reacted almost like you don't care, like it just kind of washes off. How do you really feel about it?
I don't care because obviously it's coming from an unwell person. He accused me of everything, accused his team, his trainer, the suit, injuries. Who else did he accuse? Oh, the Athletic State Commission of Nevada, they were in on it as well, the referee, whoever else. Maybe if he'd come out with one of these excuses, then it would have been believable, but not 50 of them, come on. And he can believe what he wants. What it tells me is that he's a weak, mental little person who I'm going to knock Spark out on Saturday night. I beat him the first time after 3 years out the ring. Quite comfortable, actually. He won two rounds of a 12-rounder. I absolutely obliterated him in the rematch. He didn't even win any of the rounds. And in this third fight, I just see much more the same. In fact, he's even copying me. Look, he's got no T-shirt on today. He learned that from me. I'm famous for wearing no shirt press conferences and having no shirts on. This guy's copying me all the time. And I know it's I'm an inspiring person and everybody wants to be like T. But you know, it's supposed to be Bronze Bomber. Do your own thing. Stop copying the Gypsy King. And listen, I hope you got your excuse book ready, Dosser. And what's he doing here? He should have had the sack as well, JD's. Because if Mark Brilliant was doing it, he was in on it as well because he was in the changing rooms. Watch my hands get wrapped. I want to know what you've got to say, JD's. You was there. Are you on in the conspiracy as well?
We are going to bring trainers up later on.
It was actually him who taped the knuckle dusters on. It was JD's who taped the knuckle dusters on my gloves.
Deontay.
He was there.
You clearly believe that these violations truly happened, right? So what
steps... He don't believe that, Kate.
What steps have your team taken to make sure that this is a clean fight, that you guarantee yourself that this time around?
We got a lot of things in order. You know, and I think this is what the world, only thing they need to know, you know. There's a lot of things that I can say and put out there, but, you know, like I've always been since from day one, silence is golden.
Do you think you've put yourself under more pressure with all the reasons about why the loss in the second fight happened? Do you now feel under more pressure to come out and look spectacular in this third fight?
Not at all. When you know the truth, they said the truth will set you free. There's no pressure on me. And then when you have nothing to lose, there's no pressure at all. All the pressure is on him.
So how you feel if you got nothing to lose in this fight?
It's nothing to lose. Nothing to lose and everything to gain.
Why'd you say nothing to lose? Because I think a lot of people would say that your legacy is potentially on the line in this
your
fight.
Legacy only dies when the man dies, when the desire and the fire is out your heart for the sport or anything that you do in life. When that dies, so does your legacy. And I'm well alive.
Amen. Listen, you're the only undefeated heavyweight champion that remains of the group, right? Is that pressure
for you?
I said
that yesterday. I've come under a lot of scrutiny from it all. I've come under a lot of pressure. Because I forgot that Alexander Usyk's been a world champion for 5 minutes. Forgive me on that one. I do apologize.
You're right. Sorry.
Usyk, he just won all the belts. So congratulations to him, by the way. But I was just talking about the group that we were in before Usyk even come into the picture.
Mm-hmm.
Out of all of us from like years gone by, like say the last 10 years, there's only me, last man standing. And I'm the one who's had all the problems, all inactivity, everything. And I'm still here, still undefeated. I'm a lone soldier now. Last one undefeated. Actually, the first two-time heavyweight champion of the world who never lost a fight. How amazing is that?
You have
history maker, if I was interested in that sort of thing.
You've talked a lot about mental health, right? That's something that we've all appreciated, you being really open and honest about. Do you feel mental pressure coming into a fight like this, and how do you deal with that? What do you make sure you have in your surroundings to keep you in the right place mentally?
You know, mental health struggle's no joke. You know, it's you can never get over it. It's not if or when, but it's not if, but it's definitely when. Mental health will always creep back into your life at some point, and it's a very, very, very dangerous matter. And it's a global pandemic on its own. Without COVID and all that stuff, the mental health struggle is real. And if you don't keep it at bay and take the right procedures to handle it, then you're going to wind up in a very bad position, like I was at one stage in my life. But I've learned to manage and maintain it all now, and look at me, I'm flying. I'm stood here as a heavyweight champion of the world, WBC, Ring Magazine, lineal champion, undefeated in 30-odd fights, still good-looking, lost me hair, but whatever. still a fine specimen of a man, and still confident as ever, and still on top of the world. So life's good. Life's very good. Very happy.
Where are you emotionally, Deontay? Because you're really big on energy, right? What's your energy towards Tyson Fury at this point in time?
My energy is like my mind is very violent, you know? So I'm just ready to go October the 9th. You know, we dedicated, I've dedicated myself. I devoted my time and my body, me and my team, reinvented. I'm ready to reintroduce myself to the world, you know.
I've seen you wearing all that gear, which has the Russian slogan on it, right? Which says glass to glass, which means eye for an eye, I think, correct?
For sure.
What does that mean to you in the context of this fight?
Exactly what it means.
What do you want to repay him with? A loss for a loss? Is that what you're looking at? Or how do you mean it?
I'm going to let you be the judge come Saturday night.
All right, fair enough.
I've learned to choose my words wisely, you know. Mm-hmm. People always take my words out of context, you know, and that's why I've been very silent, you know. Like I said, silence is golden. And at this point in time, it's all action for me. Action, action, action. I don't have many words to say, you know. I wasn't planning on even talking today.
I was going to
have Malik coming up. But, you know, I respect you, Kate.
Thank you.
And I'm just ready to show action.
I respect you wanting to show what you want to show in the ring as well. All right, listen, we're going to bring up the fighters, trainers, both of them in just a second. Please don't go anywhere. We'll be right back after a short break. Fury's trainer, Sugar Hill Stewart, good to see you. And Deontay Wilder's trainer, Malik Scott. Malik, good to see you too. Malik, talk to me. Deontay says that you've been able to bring something out of him that nobody else had. Why is that?
I'm a student of the game, obviously. And so Deontay, in my opinion, he ruled the heavyweight division, had 10 defenses at that time, and was just using one weapon. And on certain occasions, he'll use two or three. But over the years, being in training camp with him and boxing, I used to always say, when he get into a fight, a lot of those things disappear. And I just never understood why. And it's because he got content with just knocking people out with one weapon, which was the right hand. What I did was I went to his toolbox. I didn't give him the toolbox. I went in and I pulled everything out that I feel as though that he'd do well. And I made sure we didn't do it from a subconscious state, or we didn't do it by accident. And the way to make sure it wasn't done from a subconscious state was constantly do it and drill it over and over and over again. And that's what I did. So it's not like I gave him a toolbox and I'm teaching him something new. Everything I'm teaching him, I may put it in different variations of things to have him throw in combinations. What I don't have Deontay Wilder doing is doing choreographic pad work. What I don't have Deontay Wilder doing is ducking down to the ground like he's fighting Black Pernell Whitaker. He's fighting a tall guy. If a 6'7 guy is fighting a 6'7 guy, somebody has to get under a hook. I have tons of examples to prove this stuff. So we'll say some people were saying, well, why do he have Deontay Wilder ducking under a hook? He's a tall guy. Yeah, he's fighting a taller guy too. I don't want my fighter just catching punches. Fury's a big man, small gloves. Catching punches is damaging too. I don't want my fighter just parrying punches. I want him to be able to slip punches, parry punches. And that's where the five different dimensions then come from. Deontay Wilder can do it all. And I just pulled a lot of stuff out of him in training camp, and I made sure we drilled them with intent, not from a subconscious space.
I hear you. He's been looking great. Talk to me, Sugar Hill, because you moved into this relationship with Tyson Fury just before the second fight, right? Took over after that first fight and saw obvious opportunity to do something differently going into that second fight and switch up the approach from the first fight. What opportunity do you see going into this trilogy fight to do things differently, if any?
Well, training Tyson Fury has just been pretty much making him better. He's already been an exceptional boxer before I started training him. And just fine-tuning those skills, making sure he understands a little bit more things that maybe he didn't see, allowing him to see those things, but more importantly, just being ready. I feel like Tyson Fury being ready is unstoppable.
Malik and Deontay talk about each other as having a brotherly love relationship, right? How would you describe, Tyson, your relationship with Sugar Hill? You got your mic.
Yeah, me and Sugar go back a long way, back to like 2010, Detroit City. We've got a great bond going on, and to have any successful relationship, you've got to have good communication. And that's the most important thing in our lives, communicating with each other. And me and Sugar Hill have got that. We have this bonded glue where we gel together. We've got similar personalities. It's not easy for me to pick a trainer because I do outlandish things. I'm outspoken. I do a lot of stuff. And I've got to almost have someone on the same wavelength and personality factor to match that in order to be able to train me. And I definitely found a match with Sugar Hill here.
Is he a lot to deal with, Sugar Hill?
No.
All right, fair enough. Dante, it seems like trust was key for you when you were making the decision in terms of who you wanted to be the head guy in your corner. Where does that trust come from with Malik? And has he surprised you with everything else that he's been able to bring to the table for you?
I trust my brother with my life as he trusts me with his, you know. I'll give my shirt off my back as he would for me, you know, and that's how it's always been from the first connection. See, when we both first met, it was just, the energy was just, it was connection. You know, sometimes you can meet other humans and you just, your energy is just, it just don't mix with each other. And then you can meet others that is just like, damn, where you been all my life? You know what I'm saying? And that's how it was with him. And fun fact, my birthday and his mother lands on the same day, and his birthday and my mother's land on the same day. And when I met him, he brought his family along. We was in camp to see him. I cooked for them, the Southern hospitality. And we got to know each other even more. Even when we fought each other, it brought us even more closer, more so than ever. And in boxing, you need people that you can trust in this sport. I mean, this is a money-driven sport. There's so many loopholes and different things that can go in, and you just never know who may be jealous, who may envy you in certain ways. Even when you think the ones that really love you, or you have them at your dinner table with your children, and they play with your children, you know. And sometimes that's just not the case. But with him, you know, with all of his, all my guys, you know, I don't have a big entourage. I don't need so, mm-hmm. You know. And it's just the love that we have for each other, all of us, that we have.
Come on, get a room.
So
get over with.
I think, Malik, one of the things that people have been super interested in is watching how much you've been working on fundamentals. And that's been something that you guys have talked about openly, right? I think people on the back of that really want to know, what does that mean for Deontay Wilder in terms of the way he approaches this fight? Does he come out aggressive? Quickish answer if you can, sorry.
Well, when it comes to working with Deontay fundamentals, it was easy because he have good fundamentals. It's just at times a lot of times he didn't use them. So it goes back to the statement that I'm really just reminding him about so many different tools that he just wasn't using. And we wasn't going to do those things one time on one sparring partner good and then forget about it. No, we're fighting Tyson Fury. And fighting Tyson Fury, he's not just fighting Tyson Fury. I'm going against the intelligent, great brain as far as Sugar Hill, because Sugar Hill come from the claw. So when I approach a fight like it's the opponent, then it's the brain behind the opponent. And that's strong coming from over there. And what that did was it created a fervor, an anger kind of. So when I would do film study and I would have scheduled 10, 12 rounds for him to spar, I say, no, we're doing 16 rounds. I'm going to stay up till 5 a.m. to do film study. I'm going to call you at 2 in the morning to get you up. I'm going to make sure Joey Scott is on you about, because I know who we're facing.
And knowing who you're facing and how he's likely going to come out, do you start equally as aggressively? Is that the game plan?
The game plan is we have an answer for anything Tyson Fury do. Anything.
Tyson is obviously a very confident man, right? But we all know that Deontay Wilder is live in any fight. Do you have to work to keep his confidence at bay just to make sure that he keeps that in check, that Deontay is a dangerous opponent?
No, that wouldn't be true. Tyson Fury is he's very conscious of Deontay Wilder, his abilities, as well as myself being conscious of him. And it's just being sharp, it's just staying focused. And it's also just learning more, you know. There's always something to learn in boxing, and Tyson's taking that very well, and he's enjoying learning and having fun with it. So having fun and learning and executing and, you know, trying to be the best, being perfect at what you do, you know, that just makes for a better Tyson Fury. And I'm excited for this Saturday coming up, actually, to see what Deontay and Malik's been working on, my man Malik. And, you know, I'm happy for him. And I want to see what they have. I mean, I've known Malik for a while, and you know, it's exciting. It's exciting to be in this position, you know, going against Malik, and you know, just seeing what we know, where we come from, and put it all to work on Saturday. Yeah, it's exciting. I do believe in what they've been doing and what they've been working on. I've seen some of the clips, and it makes me more excited to get up and to get Tyson going even more,
for
just
real.
Like myself, since
for
we're
sure.
so much similar. And just expecting nothing but the same, but a knockout.
I appreciate hearing that respect. Thank you very much. Sugar Hill Stewart, fantastic to have you with us. Malik Scott, also appreciate your time. Listen, we are going to go to a very short break. Both fighters, Tyson Fury and Deontay Wilder, will deliver their closing comments in just a minute. Stay with us. I'm assuming opportunity for the fighters to give their final address to the media, to everybody watching, to all the fans out there at home. Deontay, it's the last time that we're going to ask you to do this. I know you particularly are sick of the media this time around. You can have your opportunity to give your final comments.
One more that I can say that hasn't already been said, you know. I just tell you guys, prepare yourself and prepare yourself on the battlefield and get ready for war. Because this is right here, because this is going to be an amazing fight on October the 9th. And as you see, I'm wearing my red outfit, so I want it back in blood. And I'm looking forward to it. And I'll see you guys there.
Tyson, you're up.
Well, I've got a lot to say, actually. Here's something that I think I need to say. It's like, Wilder said that I only won the second fight because I cheated, but then he goes and changes his whole team and does all this extra training and trains as hard as he's ever trained and brung on all his team and all that. So I ask the question is, if I only won because I cheated, what was the point in changing everything and doing all this other work? Can anybody answer that question? I know he can't, doesn't have the brains to. So, no one can answer that question, can they? So, the fact that I've egg in your face, bitch, is the word. That's what we say. And here's another one. He says he wants to do bad things to me and hurt me and do all this malice feelings, and he's got anger and aggression. Well, for those who hold a hot coal with the intentions of throwing it at somebody, guess what? They're the ones who's going to get burnt. I don't want to hurt Deontay Wilder. I just want to beat him in a fight. And he knows what he's saying is lies. And deep down in his soul, he knows that he lost. And he'll lose again. And he lost the first time, he lost the second time, and he's gonna lose the third time. And guess what? After this fight, he'll be back working in that fast food chain that he was working at earlier on in his career. Because that's the only place he's gonna be well.
It's easy to answer
retirement
your question.
For him.
It's
retirement,
easy to answer
Dosser.
Your question.
Retirement, Dosser.
The answer to your question is why you changed for the first and second.
No, that ain't the answer to the question. That's another question. So that's not an answer. If I only won because I cheated, why do all this extra training?
Why you change? Why you change the first and second? Why you change the first and second?
As long as I didn't cheat.
So ask yourself that question.
You go ask yourself the question. If I've done all this cheating,
I see nervous energy.
Yeah. Then why has he not prepared himself? He hasn't done any extra steps at all to stop me from cheating again.
Why you explain yourself?
I'm not explaining myself. I'm asking you a question.
You haven't denied any
what
allegations
have you done?
To this point.
I don't need to deny it because it's
you
true.
You know what I'm saying? You
it's
haven't denied any
I
allegations.
On. I had a turbo jet.
You don't, even,
on
you don't even want certain media in here to give
all
you the tough
it.
Questions.
All
you have
it.
Nobody to give you the tough questions.
And there's nobody in here to ask me a tough question.
So when it's like
you're
that.
You're in denial and you're getting knocked out.
Yeah, let's make it
happen. And you're going to retire.
You you don't know nothing about knocking no one out.
Do yourself a favor.
You don't have knockout power.
Your legacy's in bits.
Even in my worst times, you still hit like a bitch. I didn't
no
feel
one's
nothing.
Even believed you.
I didn't feel
you're
anything. You were wondering
like
why I kept getting up and getting up.
Because really
I didn't feel, nothing. You have no power.
Million
you're not a
excuses.
Knockout artist.
Well, I knocked you out, didn't I, Dosser?
Nah, I went out on my feet.
That's a knockout.
I had a disloyal trainer to throw the towel in.
Dosser.
And guess what? When
knocked
someone
out.
Throw the towel in, after the boss tell them not to do, the employee get fired.
Yeah, but you Term said I had knuckle dusters on. JD is in the room while I had the fucking guts on.
That don't
Why
matter.
Didn't he say something then? He's in on it,
don't
too.
Don't worry about him.
He's in on
don't,
it.
Don't worry about him. I handle
and
my team.
And him behind
like
you.
I handle my
Shelly
team.
Finkel, he's in
you
on
handle
too.
Yours like you handle yours.
You're a weak man. You get
yeah,
knocked
thank
out.
You.
End off.
Thank you. I'm the one that defended my title 10 times.
I go down in history as six.
Titles.
How many times
that's
have you defended?
Like you. How many times? Like
I don't have the team.
I don't need to.
I've never had the team in years.
I've come here.
If you look up your history and you look up my history, which I advise everyone to do their homework.
Just to stay on a training day.
You look up you and you look up me. I'm a nun in this sport, baby.
You ain't
I don't have to cheat.
You will only
I don't have
to
eat boar meat. I don't have to stick shit up my ass to make me feel a certain type of way.
That's your legacy.
I don't have to use certain things. I don't have to manipulate my gloves. I don't have to do those things.
You have to do it all. You have to do it all.
So at night when I look into the mirror, I'm being trained by a loser, so that makes two losers, a real champion.
And you're going to get knocked out on Saturday night. No problem. I don't feel you, because you're a lying little dog. And if I don't stub another glove in my life, I'm good.
That's the difference between me and you. I don't have to fight another day in my life.
Doesn't matter.
I'm good.
Because your legacy's already finished.
I'm good.
All the excuses.
I'm good. How, can you say the same thing?
You've been done. Finished.
Can you say the same thing?
You've been beat. You've been humiliated. And you've been busted.
And let's get rid of it.
End of. And that's it. And there's no one
there
in here
energy.
Can accept the fact that this little pussy got his ass handed to him, not once, but twice, and he can't do nothing about it!
Because
he ain't fucking man enough!
I accept
that's why!
It. I accept with, look.
Tell him what to say, Shelly, come on. Tell him what to say.
When I was in the condition I was in, I could have stopped before. I could have went back to my corner, but you know what? I'm a king. I'm a warrior. I accepted what I was going through to still fight you.
Yeah, you look like a dosser.
I still accepted it. And you still couldn't knock me out. You still couldn't do that. But guess what? If the roles were reversed and you was in the situation I was
in,
they would have called 911.
Your trainer, Jay Diaz.
Someone please call 911.
He did you a favor, Mark Breland. He saved your life that night.
Don't know.
You didn't want to sack him. You wanted to give him a pay rise.
I don't want to die in the ring, so it ain't no saving my life. That's why I do the things outside of the ring.
Tyson.
And my family have an understanding, my children have an understanding that daddy has a dangerous job. You know, there's no other sport in this world that have collected as many lives as boxing.
Amen
so
to
I
that.
Understand what I'm going through.
And
so,
we respect both of you for those reasons. Can
children?
I ask both of you
I don't respect
to stand
he's
up?
A bum.
Deontay, will you do us a favor? Can
bum
you
dosser.
Stand up? We're going to do a face-off
actually,
one final time. We have a huge show coming up for you on Saturday night.
Ain't doing much. Take a step back. Cause it's Elie Seckbach.